Assalamu alaikum. I am going to talk to you today a little bit about why I'm doing a 3-day water fast, well, liquid fast, and what are some of the benefits. I got a lot of questions last time. People DM me wanting to know more about why I'm fasting, what are the benefits, and how do you go about doing it? So I thought I'd come live today and let you know what are the benefits and why I'm doing what I'm doing. If you are just joining me, my name is Mubaraka Ibrahim and I am a health and happiness coach, and I appreciate your attention for a few minutes. I'm going to try to be very succinct today. I got notes, y'all. I'm getting fancy. I'm not just talking off the top of my head no more. I got notes. So, if you're joining me, give me a salam and tell me where you are logging in from. I am gonna just try to pull up my Facebook here so that I can actually respond to messages via typing them if I need to, or respond to comments if I need to via typing them. Let me know where you're logging in. Let's give people a couple minutes to log in. If you joined me yesterday, I talked to you a little bit about how I am trying to make my foot pain better. It is not like a constant pain, but there's some inflammation, and I am trying to naturally, through movement and diet, and improve it. And so one of those things that I'm doing is I am doing a 3-day fast. Let me see. For me, I'm about at hour 19 of 36 hours. Assalamu alaikum, Sama from Texas. And I saw somebody from Pakistan. Yes, Aisha from Pakistan. Assalamu alaikum. I am at about hour 18. So I had dinner last night. After I had dinner, that was kind of like my cutoff. So 9 o'clock, no food after 9 o'clock. I woke up this morning, I had some water. I had some Earl Grey tea. If you follow me on Instagram, then I posted a little reel about the benefits of Earl Grey tea. We'll talk about that on another live. And then, so my energy level was fine. I had a client at 7:30. I had a client at 8:30. I had a client at 10 that was scheduled for 10 o'clock. And I was good during most of that. Then I guess I started feeling a little bit tired, maybe around 1, maybe a little tired. I drank some water. I needed to focus on some computer work. Wa alaikum salam, Zabeniso from Ohio. So I had a couple coffee. So I drink just regular Starbucks instant coffee. And I had a cup of coffee at about 1, 1:30. I had a cup of coffee. I'm feeling pretty good, feeling okay. I think I might go for a bike ride a little later. One of the things that I am doing, the purpose of this particular fast is to decrease inflammation. And one of the things that my physical therapist asks me not to do is any activity that may aggravate my feet. And so that means walking is out, running is out, and I will have to bike ride or get on an elliptical. So I'll do one of those later, just because I personally need to stay active during this time. It should not, and it hasn't in the past interrupted my energy flow. So I will do that later. I have already warned people in my house that I will be doing a 3-day water fast. And my husband is like, yeah, okay. All right, so let's talk about this. What are some of the benefits of water fast? So I am fasting, so first let's clarify. Intermittent fasting is when you have a window of eating and a window of not eating, right? So your fasting period, your fed period, is when you do that in a 24-hour period. So sometimes people choose their intermittent fasting to be 16 hours of fasting, which is basically not eating at stop eating at 8 p.m., don't eat again until 12 noon the next day, right? Some people do 18 hours, some people do 20 hours, some people do 24 hours and then they eat the next day, right? So that depends on what your particular goal is. When it comes to intermittent fasting itself, one of the clarifications that I want you to get in your mind is that there is a difference between intermittent fasting and extended fasting. So intermittent fasting is when you break up a 24-hour period. Extended fasting is when you are going longer than 24 hours without eating food, right? So I am currently, even though I do intermittent fasting on a daily basis, I am currently doing an extended fast. So I'm gonna go through with you hour by hour what happens in our body when we go an extended period without time. Excuse me. One of the things that we also want to talk about is what's a safe amount of time that we can do that. Let me grab some water. Hold on. Because my throat might be a little parched, seeming that I am fasting. It's not an Islamic fast, so don't freak out that I'm drinking water. It's an extended fast. I'll probably do the Sunnah fast on Thursday, but for today, we are just having water, coffee, Earl Grey tea, green tea. Those are my fasting rules. Okay, so we are going to go hour by hour. Y'all with me? You ready to learn about all of the things that is going to happen in your body when you do an extended fast? Do me a favor, give this video a share. Share it on your page, invite your friends to have a watch party. That would be awesome. That would really help me to spread the word and make the world healthier and happier. So if you are on board with starting that revolution with me, go ahead and do me that favor and share, start a watch party. All right? So when you are doing, let's start hour one. Hour one through eight is generally your hours of digestion, right? So every food has a different digestion time, meaning the time that it takes to get from your mouth to your colon, right? So fruits and vegetables digest the quickest. They are generally between 40 minutes to sometimes, depending on how much fiber, it may take an hour for it to get through your entire system. Rice and pasta and those types of grains normally take about 2 hours. Fish takes about 2 hours as well. Chicken takes about 4 hours. Red meat takes a lot longer, right? Red meat takes, it can take up to anywhere between 8 hours to 12 hours to actually get through your entire system. When it comes to your metabolic function, part of your metabolic function, and this is a side note to fasting, is how long it takes your body and how much energy your body uses to digest a food, right? So because protein, animal proteins in particular, take longer for your body to digest, they are considered metabolic boosters. You are going to boost your metabolism because your body is expending extra energy to digest those foods, right? It has to break it down a little bit more. So that's an important side note. That's not a negative thing. That's just the way food works. That's the way our body likes to work, the way our body actually increases our metabolism. So between hour one and eight, you're still kind of like digesting your food. Now, once you reach about hour 12, that is when the good stuff starts to happen. So the minimum amount of time for it to be considered a fast is really 12 hours. That's like the minimum time. So what happens at the 12-hour point that makes it such a magical hour? Well, after when you're digesting food, and we're making the assumption that you're eating a regular diet that has grains, that has fruits and vegetables, that has protein, right? So even though I teach people how to follow a healthy lifestyle using ketogenic eating, in addition to intermittent fasting, I'm making the assumption that everybody watching this may not necessarily be on a ketogenic diet. So this is generally what happens to everybody's system. It's not specifically for people who are on a ketogenic plan. So after about 12 hours, your liver depletes itself of glycogen, right? So when you eat a grain, when you eat a carbohydrate, when you eat sugar, when you eat any source of carbohydrates, your body takes that carbohydrate, right, the nutrient that you're eating, and it converts it into a sugar inside of your body called glucose. You've probably heard of glucose. Glucose is your metabolic sugar, right? So when you eat rice, your body turns it into glucose. When you eat pasta, your body turns it into glucose. Doesn't matter if it's white rice, brown rice, black rice, green or purple rice, as they say. If it's a carbohydrate, it's turning into sugar. When you eat bread, it's turning into sugar. Obviously, sugar is sugar, turns into sugar in your blood. So your body, so what's important in this process is for you to understand that your body stores sugar, it's glucose, right? When you take that in three places. The first place that it stores it is it's going through your bloodstream. The second place is that it converts that glucose into a substrate called glycogen. And glycogen is inside of your liver, and then it also puts it inside of your muscles, right? So that is how your body is going to store those things. It takes about 12 hours for your liver to be depleted of glycogen, right? And so after 12 hours, you no longer have glycogen in your liver, and your liver starts saying, where am I going to get energy? Because I've been using this glucose and glycogen to convert it into energy so I can do all of the stuff that I need to do. Well, what happens is your body actually turns that into it starts happening into fat and turning it into ketones, because ketones is another form of energy for your body. So it's not some strange thing that happens when you get on a weird diet, or it is a natural part of your metabolic process. It's an alternative fuel source, right? Remember the other day, and I described how it's kind of like the generator to your energy. Well, that is what that's what ketones are. So that happens at about 12 hours. Why is that important? That's important because your glucose, and let's use glucose and glycogen together, because glycogen comes from glucose, right? So I'm going to just use the term glucose. When your glucose is high, that is what that's what makes your body produce insulin. And remember, I'm always talking about insulin is the domino hormone. Well, when that glycogen is depleted, so does your insulin come down. Once you get your insulin down, your insulin level down, and the insulin production that you're making, that is when all of the magic starts to happen. So, hour 12, now all of your glycogen is depleted from your liver. Hour 12 to 16, that is when we see a spike in HGH, human growth hormone. It is a natural hormone in our body. Why it's important for us, and why you may be following this page, is because it is your fat burning hormone. You know how people are always saying, oh, we're gonna boost your fat burning hormones. You gotta know what specific hormones are you trying to boost that is going to increase lipolysis, which is your body's ability to convert fat, to break down fat cells, right? What's that gonna be? That is gonna be HGH. HGH is important for a couple of reasons. Number one, when HGH raises, your body can build more lean muscle, right? So a lot of times you will find bodybuilders who are familiar with this information will actually practice intermittent fasting, because it has shown that even with just 16 hours of intermittent fasting, your HGH can increase fivefold, right? Just with 16 hours. The other important part about HGH and why it's so important is if you are pre-diabetic, diabetic, or have PCOS, you should know that HGH is the counter of insulin. Anytime your insulin rises, HGH lowers. Anytime HGH rises, your insulin lowers. So HGH actually, it is a great hormone to fight insulin, making it go down. So hour 16, your HGH starts going up. The other important part of, HGH is a fat burner. It's your fat burning hormone. It increases lean muscle, and it also decreases your insulin level. That's something that you want to keep up. So that's another reason why, for example, another way to raise HGH is doing high intensity interval training. If you have diabetes, pre-diabetic, you have a family history of diabetes like I do, you have PCOS or other metabolic conditions that affect your insulin level, you definitely want to do some high intensity interval training as your form of exercise, not just walking. Walking is still good, but that is actually the exercise prescription to help you to improve those conditions. All right, so that is hour 12 to 16. So between hours 18 and 24, that is for the people who are looking to lose weight. And a lot of people are really surprised at this, because we so often see everybody say, hey, you should fast for 16 hours, 16-8. It's the most common way that people fast, right? However, the only reason why it's the most common way is that it's what most people are willing to do. But you're not most people. I'm absolutely sure of it. You're willing to do whatever you have to do in order for you to take full control over your health. Now, if you are that person, then you want to listen up for the next couple of minutes. Number one, when they looked at, remember I used that word lipolysis earlier, which is your body's physical chemical reaction in your body of breaking down fat cells. They know that when you start fasting, okay, from that 12-hour mark, your body starts breaking down fat cells, right? And they looked at, okay, that's speeding up, that metabolism is speeding up, those fat cells are being broken down consistently and greater than they would during a time that you're not fasting. But when hour 18 hits, the lipolysis goes like this, and it goes up. And then about hour 24, it starts leveling out again, like that, right? It's still higher than it was when you're not fasting, but there is a huge spike between hour 18 and 20, right? So if your goal is to use intermittent fasting as a method in your weight loss tool belt, then at least couple days a week, you should be doing that 18 to 20 hour fast, because you're gonna get a really big spike, right, at that 18-20 mark. Now, if you're the type of person and you're like, oh my God, I cannot go 20 hours without eating something, start slow if you need to. Start off with just skipping breakfast, and then day by day, add a half an hour, you would definitely start being more inclined to it. I promise you, you will not starve. And when you do eat, make sure you're eating a nice nutrient-dense meal, right? So you're gonna eat with intentions. You're not gonna be like, oh, I fasted for 20 hours and now I can have pizza and donuts and soda. No, you've put the work in, you sacrifice, you're gonna have a very nutrient dense meal when you break that fast. Okay, so now we're at hour 24. What happens in your body after 24 hours? Oh, I forgot this too. So in another research study, it actually shows that if you suffer from conditions like IBS, Crohn's disease, that intermittent fasting has been shown to actually increase good gut bacteria. It has been shown both in animal and human studies that it's beneficial for these conditions. The other thing that happens, so here's another one, and this one really spikes at the 24-hour mark, is when you fast, the benefit to your brain, number one, your brain functions really well and very efficiently. In fact, some studies show 30% better on ketones than it does glucose. And this is really surprising to a lot of people because for many years, we used to think, oh, the brain needs glucose. But what we discovered is actually it doesn't. It can function well and even better off of ketones. Why? Because one of the side effects of your body using ketones instead of glucose is that it increases a protein called BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. That is considered like jet fuel for your brain. Now, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, BDNF, has been associated, its presence and its absence have been associated with a lot of brain-related diseases. So, for example, in both animals and human studies, fasting has been shown to be beneficial for the brain of people with multiple sclerosis, people with Parkinson's, people with early onset dementia and Alzheimer's, because it actually increases BDNF in the brain. BDNF literally protects the neuron. It's like the army for the brain. It protects the neurons of the brain and it actually helps build new neurons. So fasting, a lot of people will say, they may think that fasting is gonna make me think slower. If I don't have anything to eat, then I'm not gonna be able to get my tasks done. It in fact works the opposite direction. And I know a lot of people are like, well, how is all this when all this time we've been told that we need to eat? Think about it in a practical way, right? So let's imagine that we were back in the days where we lived in the bush and we hunted for our food and we scavenged for our grains and our fruits and vegetables. If you got to a point where it's winter time, or you're a nomad, you need to figure out which way the animals went in order for you to go and get food. If you went without food and your brain began to work slower and you weren't able to figure out all of the nuances about your geography, about tracking, about where food, what was safe, what would happen? We would be at risk. Our survival, literal survival, would have been at risk. So Allah made our body in such a wonderful format, such an ideal format to be put on this earth for us to provide for ourselves, is that when we are without food, our brain actually works clearer and better in the past so that we could go get food, so we can figure out how to live and how to survive and how to sustain ourselves. Because if we went without food and we all were just like, we couldn't do anything, then you would actually be more likely to starve and die. So this is a survival mechanism initially for us that has become pretty much obsolete because most people don't engage in fasting, right? Some people live 20, 30, 40 years and they never go more than 12 hours without eating something, right? This is kind of like the side effect of living in a Western culture or a developed culture, that you are always eating and we are promoting eating all of the time. And so whereas our ancestors were very familiar with going with food and then without food and was able to survive on both and was grateful for both situations, we're just like, oh my God, it's lunchtime. I didn't eat breakfast. I'm gonna die. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. Not because it is, it's because somebody told us it was and we kept on doing it. Oh, I need to eat every 3 hours or I'm gonna die. No, you're not. All of those are false. There's no science behind it. It was said and then repeated. Fasting will actually make you healthier, stronger, smarter. You can tell them that I said, okay? And there's research to back it up. So what happens, okay, so now we're at the 24 hour mark, right? So 24 hours to 48 hours, 48 hours, what happens? So our fat burning, that lipolysis that kicked up between 18 and 24, right? That lipolysis, now it starts to level out a little bit, right? And so if your goal is weight loss, it's really not beneficial for you to consistently do 48-hour fast, 36-hour fast, right? So know that if you decide to use intermittent fasting as a tool in your tool belt, there are different protocols based on what your goal is, right? So if your goal is weight loss, that 18 to 24-hour mark is pretty good. But going over 24 hours saying like, oh, I want to lose weight, so I'm not going to eat for 30 days. Sounds crazy, but there are many, I'm in those groups. I don't comment. I just watch people's posts. Like, yeah, I'm on day 17 of my 30-day fast. Not a good idea. What you're doing is you're really starving yourself. And yeah, you'll lose weight, but you'll also compromise your health because the weight that you're losing is starvation weight. It is not a healthy weight loss. So if anybody says, hey, would you like to do a 1 week fast with me? Say, nope, my coach Mubaraka said I can't do that. Put it on me, blame it on me. Tell them to send me a message and I'll explain to them why. We'll send them this video, okay? So no 7 day fast, okay? Fat loss pretty much evens out after 24 hours. Now, another benefit of fasting, and this is like really my favorite benefit, right? Autophagy. Some people pronounce it autophagy. I think it's pronounced autophagy. Tomatoes, tomatoes, right? So it is your cellular detox. And I talked about this really quickly last time. But when you are in a state of autophagy, your body is literally rebuilding itself from the inside out, right? It's literally rebuilding and restoring your cells. Now, yes, there is very strong research that shows that you can reset your immune system by doing a 3-day fast. But I don't want you to think more is better, because it's not. The research also shows that autophagy levels out after about 36 hours. So no, a 7-day fast is not going to make you more detoxed than doing a 3-day fast. I want you guys to limit it. If you decide to try this, definitely want to limit it to 3 days. You don't want to be going a week, 10 days, 30 days without eating food. That is not the best way for you to achieve any of these benefits, either weight loss, detoxification, balance of insulin. That's not the method that we want to use for those things. So in 72 hours, what happens is not only does autophagy detox you from the cellular level, it is also an anti-aging mechanism. So part of our aging process is that we have telomeres. And when we are young, our telomeres are nice and long, right? And this is one of the ways that a doctor, a person that looks at your DNA can actually look and tell how old you are biologically, right? So some of us, we're 30 in age, but biologically, your body is actually telling you you're 60, right? So the way that they look at biologically how old you are is looking at the length of your telomeres, right? Which are inside of your DNA. Well, when we get older, those telomeres shorten. So kind of like think of it like as you age, it's like, okay, you're aging. We're getting shorter, 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 right? Fasting lengthens the telomeres. It can literally reverse your biological age. That is very powerful. This is something that simply by choosing when you eat, we're not even talking about what you eat yet. We're just talking about when you eat. Simply by choosing when you eat, you can reverse your biological age and improve your health. It is an anti-aging mechanism. So, those are some of the things that is going to be helpful as a result of fasting. I'm not recommending that everybody do a 3-day fast. I am just giving information. I have to do my obvious disclaimer is if you have any diagnosed illness, you need to speak to your medical professional. I am not a doctor. I am an information gatherer and disperser. Okay, so here is what is considered a fast, because I saw that question at some point. When you fast, remember the goal is not just to go without food. The goal of the fast that makes all of these wonderful things happen is for your insulin level to drop, right? So that is the goal. I say that because at the very beginning of the live today, we talked about all the things that turns into sugar into your blood that causes your body to produce insulin, right? All of those things. Well, you want to make sure you do not trigger those things during your fast. So that means you can have water. You can have up to 2 cups of black coffee. Don't have more than 2, because when you have more than 2 cups of coffee, it can actually increase cortisol, which then triggers insulin, right? So 2 cups of coffee. You can have green tea and you can have Earl Grey tea. I know people are gonna send me messages and say, oh, but what about this particular herbal tea and that particular herbal tea? Don't have herbal teas, okay? Only because there is not enough research to show which tea raises your insulin level. And if your insulin level starts to go up, then you are mitigating all of these beneficial effects, all right? The tea and coffee also has to be no sugar, no honey, no coconut sugar, no whatever, no agave, no types of sweetener. Even though I would normally approve monk fruit and stevia, don't even have it during your fast, right? You want to be, I'm sort of a fasting purist. You want to make sure that you do not do anything to trigger insulin. Honey sends your insulin level skyrocket, right? You don't want to have honey inside of your tea when you are in your fast. The same thing for all of the other sugars, even things like aspartame, which you shouldn't eat anyway because it's connected to cancers, but sucralose, any of the OSes that you see, oh, well, it's sugar-free and it's calorie-free, don't have it. Nothing that sends your insulin level up. And of course, I'm gonna mention, as I mention every time I talk fasting, that includes juicing. I'm on a campaign against juicing, I'll be completely honest, right? So when you're juicing carrots and bananas and peaches and apples, you are concentrating the sugar in the fruit. When you take in that sugar, your glucose and insulin is going to go up. Our goal is detox. When I talked about autophagy, and how it's cellular detox, autophagy does not rise in the presence of insulin. So when your insulin level is high, your autophagy is like, nope, I'm gonna stay right here. I'm cruising, right? Generally, when we sleep, our insulin level goes down and autophagy raises slightly. This is a natural process. Our body actually wants to clean, restore, repair itself. But it can only do that when we allow our digestive system to rest. So whether you're doing intermittent fasting for 16 or 18 hours, or you decide to do a 48-hour or a 36-hour fast, you don't want to do anything that is going to damper down or mitigate the autophagy process. And anytime your insulin level goes up, remember autophagy go down. When your insulin level goes up, HGH goes down. When your insulin level goes up, it is a domino hormone. It is going to trigger at least a dozen or more other hormones that are not beneficial to your health, right? The rise in insulin actually also cause lots of inflammatory markers to go up, right? So your insulin is all the way up here. Now your knee is gonna hurt, my foot is gonna hurt, like all of these things began to hurt because it is, every hormone is playing off the next hormone. All right, so that is what happens after 36 hours of fast. I will update you on how I feel probably in my stories. I mean, honestly, I've never had a problem doing this before, but you might be curious as to what I'm drinking. It's gonna be one of those three things. No. All right, so I will talk to you guys tomorrow when I am at hour probably, I don't know, 36, 40 by then. I am at hour 18, 19, 20, I don't know. What is it? It's 4 p.m. now. Take away 5, I'm at hour 19. 19 of 36, yeah, no. 72. I'm at hour 19 of 72. So by the time I get to my final day, what I will do is I will make sure that I come live and I talk to you specifically about the refeeding process. So that's an entirely different topic, right? When you break your fast, how should you break it? What are the things that you should be eating? How do you fast and then just not automatically reverse all of the benefits that you just got? We got to talk about that too. So make sure you subscribe to when I am going live, share this video, like the page, so that you'll get notifications when I'm live again, because we got a lot to talk about, people. All right, I'll talk to you soon. Assalamu alaikum.